Welcome to the special lecture series on ancient Indian values and its relevance in modern life. We are indeed very happy that our guest, Brahmashri Bhattatri Pad, has kindly consented and agreed to be with us to share his experiences on these ancient Indian values. I take this opportunity on behalf of all of you to welcome the guest onto the stage. I request the guest. Respected CMD, to please honor the guest with a shawl. CMD, divisional heads, senior colleagues and my friends, it is a very auspicious occasion. Today, this morning, we have an opportunity to listen to a profound, scholarly man on ancient values. Brahmashri is a tantrist, Vedic scholar, writer, exponent and speaker. He was born from the state which gave birth to a great Advaitic teacher, Sri Adi Shankaracharya. He has widely traveled in USA, Europe, England and other places, spreading across the Indian values and how it is relevant in the modern life. It is well accepted in the foreign land that the Indian values are highly rich enough to promote even the business excellence. To that extent, we would see that many of the Swamijis who origin from India, they have been in foreign land more than spending time in India. Friends, I take this opportunity to welcome Brahmashri Bhattatri Pad to be with us. I request him to invoke all gods and goddesses and seek the blessings for the prosperity of BDL and the welfare and healthy condition of all my colleague employees. I thank you. I now request Brahmashri to take over the mic. Thank you.
Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshal Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah. Respected CMD and other officers of BDL. The topic of discussion given to me today is ancient Indian values and its relevance in modern life. You go through all the Vedas and Vedic literature. The Vedic literature is so vast that the total is 5,72,000 stanzas. You go through them. Nowhere you can see a word India or Indian. You go through Smritis, they are also very vast, which are known as the interpretation of Vedic knowledge. You don't find India or Indian there. And then Itihasas and Puranas, Ramayana and Mahabharata, and 18 Puranas and 18 Upapuranas, a very vast literature. Then Shastras, Nyayam, Mimamsa, Vyakaranam, etc. Shad Darshanas. And lastly, Bhagavad Gita. In no Indian literature you can see the word India or Indian. This is a misnomer. India is a word coined by Greeks when they invaded Bharata, that is our country. Our country is Bharata. When they invaded, they came through Sindhu River. They could not pronounce the word Sindhu properly. It was misspelled as Hindu. Then those people who reside in Sindhu, on the banks of Sindhu, they were called Indians. And their language was called Hindi. These are all very recent phenomena. Then why should we identify ourselves as Indians? Why should we identify ourselves as India? If at all there is any place called India, it is Pakistan. Because the river Sindhu is mainly flowing through Pakistan. And the people residing on the banks of river Sindhu, they are all Pakistanis. So we are not Indians. Our country is not India. Our country is Bharata. And we are Bharatiyas. This is the first point I would like to make. Then, we are all made to believe that we have a religion, Hindu religion. No. We have absolutely no religion at all in the modern sense of that word. Christian religion. Muslim religion. We have no religion at all. We have a single text as Christians have Bible or Muslims have Quran. Ours is only a collection of acharas, dharma anushthana. What for? Not for a particular class of people, for the humanity. The vision is universal. It applies not only to humans. Our rishis look every living being as their brethren. Yoga samasta sukhino bhavantu means not humans alone. All living creatures. The most repeated mantra in Rigveda is Sham no bhavadvipade, Sham chatushpade. Let there be peace on this two-legged creatures and also on the four-legged. They never differentiated humans from other creatures. And they always considered nature as our mother. They always respected nature. They always tried to protect nature. So, universal brotherhood in Bharata means love of all creatures, all living organisms, from amoeba onwards. That is the vision of our ancient rishis. It was quite unfortunate that we accepted the word India in our constitution. According to me, you need not agree totally. We must have emphasized that our country is Bharata. So that is the first point I have to clarify. Then, universal love is all right. At the same time, one of the most important emphasis in Vedic texts is that you should destroy your enemy. Not tolerate. Destroy your enemy. Unequivocal terms they are using. Yosman dveshti yamja vayam dvishma is the most repeated mantra in Yajurveda. Yah asman dveshti. He who give us trouble. Yanja vayam dvishma. He troubled them. Dveshti, dvesham means hatred or killing, whatever, to any extent you can take the meaning. Yo asman dveshti yam cha vayam dushma. In my humble opinion, all the evils of this country since its independence are emanating from the facts that first we did not rename our country as Bharata. Then we never bothered to accept the message of Vedas. Destroy enemy. And then we failed to appreciate the messages in Vedas and all our texts which emphasized on the protection of nature. These are the three major evils that bestowed on us by the modern administrators. We have to emphasize that we have no religion. We have no enmity towards any other religion. See, when the Maharishis prescribe Achara Samhitas or Dharma Samhitas, they never specify any religious limits. It's all for humans. Dharma. What is the meaning of Dharma? Dharmasya tattvam nihitam guhayam mahajano yenagatasya pantha. It's a very famous text. It is very difficult to understand dharma, of course. But it is not that difficult also. Dharanal dharma. What is dharma? Whatever protects is dharma. Whatever distracts is adharma. You plant a sapling, give it water, allow it to grow. It is dharma because it is protection. You cut a tree, you kill a creature, adharma. Very simple. And this dharma they used to protect the entire nature. You know, in Bharata, the most important dharma is considered to be yajna. Why yajna? Why Maharishis evolved different forms of yajnas and panchamaha yajnas to be performed by individuals in their houses? Only to protect nature. To enliven nature, to rejuvenate nature. Their only consideration was protection of the surface of the earth, all creatures included. There is no doctrine. For us, there is no religious doctrine at all. If you are protecting nature, you are dharmika. If you are destroying, you are adharmika. Very simple. And to protect nature, they evolved yajnas and also some other method, which is called purta. That which fulfills. Purtam means that which fulfills. Ishtam and Purtam. Together it is called Ishtapurtam. So if somebody asks me what is Bharatiya Dharma, my answer is in one word, Ishtapurta. It is not at all complicated. See, our total life on this earth, our rishis have divided into Chaturyugas. They have specifically told us that we are in the 28th Chaturyuga. This is a cyclic order. And in the 28th Chaturyuga, we are in the Kali Yuga, fourth one. First is Krita Yuga, then is Treta Yuga, then comes Dwapara Yuga, and last is Kali Yuga. Fortunately, the Kali Yuga is smallest, and the Dharma Yuga or Satya Yuga, Krita Yuga is the longest. If you divide the total period of 43,20,000 years of the Chaturyuga, one unit is consisting of 4,32,000 years. Krita Yuga consists of four parts, 17,28,000 years. Then Treta Yuga, three parts. Dwapara Yuga, two parts, and Kali Yuga, only 4,32,000 years. We have already came 5,000 years over. Kali Yuga started 5,000 years ago during the birth of Krishna. Out of these four yugas, we have spent 38,90,000 years before the advent of temples in India, in Bharata. So temple is only a new phenomenon. Temple worship is a very new phenomenon. Before that, we had only yajna and purta, ishta and purta. We forgot all these things. Since independence, these basic principles involved in Arsha Dharma were ignored and neglected. That's all the evils now available. See, what is purta? Ishta, I need not explain ishta very much. What is purta? Vapi kupa tatagrani devatayatanani cha annapradanam arama purtam ityabhidhiyate. This is the definition of purta, purta karma. And purte mokshamavapnuyal they have described. Ishtena labhate swargam purte mokshamavapnuyal. So, if you do any purta karma, you can go straight away to the Brahma without any rebirth. What are they? Construction of tanks, wells, lakes, and then giving food to the poor, and protection of forests. Devatayatanam
is protection of forests. We forgot all these things. In my younger days, Kerala was full of tanks everywhere. Wherever you go, you can see paddy fields, and in those fields there were ever so many tanks. You go now to Kerala, all those tanks are filled. They are converted into housing colonies. They are converted into coconut gardens. Agriculture is no more prevalent. But recently, I went to Assam and the northeast areas. There, still the agriculture is alive, and there are ever so many tanks full of water. So, what I have to emphasize is, the most valuable thing in the ancient Bharata is the message that you must have tanks, wells and lakes everywhere, then only you can protect nature. If this message is imbibed by the administrators of Andhra, this state can be converted into an evergreen forest within 10 years. So you have vast areas uncultivated, without trees, only shrubs, dry, barren. Nowadays, Westerners are telling about harvesting rain. This rain harvest was prevalent thousands of years ago in our country. We ignored it. See, in my younger days, from Arakkonam to Chennai, Madras, you can see lakes on both sides. Tanks are built and rainwater is stored till the outskirts of Chennai, up to that point. And Chennai was full of water. The Tapakulam in Mylapore temple was full even during summer years, summer days. What is the situation now? It is dry. All the lakes from Arakkonam to Chennai are neglected. Bunds are damaged. Water is not being stored. So the most important message, value of Bharata in the ancient time was to protect nature by preserving, of course, forests and at the same time digging water resources. This is the most important thing we have to do. And then, see, our behavior towards our enemies. All our problems in Kashmir, whether it is Kashmir or whether it is Pakistan, all are due to the soft stand we are taking against enemies. Veda never said to take a soft stand. So, see, yo asman dveshti yam cha vayam dushma. In the year 1947-48, there were infiltration in Kashmir. The then Home Minister Patel told Jawaharlal Nehru, give me 2 hours. I will make them run away. But a soft stand was taken. In the year 1965, during Lal Bahadur Shastri's regime, the chiefs of staffs were given free hands and they went up to Karachi, but simply retracted. We could have very easily made Pakistan to sign whatever we dictate. We could have made them vacate Kashmir. The entire Kashmir. But we didn't. We were taking a soft stand. Whenever there is a problem, we go to UN. That is not the message given by our ancient scriptures. Be tough towards enemies. These two aspects we ignored. Then, see, the attitude of rishis towards life, they always wanted men to be happy. How to be happy? By having more wealth? No, they realized. You reduce your requirements. You train your mind to get satisfied with whatever you have. That is the way to be happy. So they advocated shamam, dhamam, yamam, etc. See, a very simple stanza. Chitte tu sukhi, te sarvam bhavel sukhamayam jagal. Upanal gudhapadasya sarva charmastrareva hu. Chitte sukhi tu. If you are happy in your heart, in your mind, te sarvam bhavel sukhamayam jagal. For those who feel contented at heart, they are always happy. And an example is given. Upanal gudhapadasya sarva charmastrareva hu. If you have two pieces of leather under your feet, that is chappals, then it is as if the entire earth is covered by leather. Wherever you step, there is leather. The effect for you is the same if the entire earth is covered by leather. And if the earth is not covered, your legs are having two pieces of leather under your feet. The effect is the same. So, to be happy is to make your heart feel contented with minimum requirements. Yena kena chidachanno, yena kena chidashrita, yatra kvachana shayi syal tam deva brahmanam. Who are having the minimum requirements of clothing, food and shelter. They are called Brahmanas. This was the message of our rishis in ancient Bharata. The
present trend by Westerners to increase requirements. What is the result? Nobody is satisfied. You sit before the TV for a while. A number of articles are advertised. See, our mind is always restless. Oh, that is a good thing. Another thing is good. Like that, our requirements are increased. Your sorrow is increased. Not satisfaction, not happiness. So, we must try to reduce our requirements. Be satisfied with whatever we have. Then only we can be happy. This is the message of our ancient rishis. This is the value they have given us. We are not taking into account this message. Another sorry state of affairs. You see, Bharatavarsha were a treasure house of knowledges. Veda is a treasure house of knowledge. Vid means to know. Veda is knowledge. The Indian Institute of Scientific Heritage, functioning from Trivandrum in Kerala, headed by Dr. Sambashivan and Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan, they have published a lot of small booklets wherein you can see a lot of informations which are very, very relevant in modern times. All the discoveries attributed to Westerners were made by our rishis thousands of years ago. They are ignored by us. Even though printed texts are available, like that of Aryabhatta, they are not at all seriously considered by our administrators. And our children, growing children, are taught that all the discoveries of modern sciences are by Westerners only. Let me quote one or two examples, not all. We attribute the attraction of the earth, attractive power of the earth to Sir Isaac Newton. Before the birth of Isaac Newton, centuries ago, not only years ago, centuries before Isaac Newton, our rishis discovered attraction. And that too with more clarity. I shall quote a stanza. Agrishtishat Krishchamahi Taya Yel Khastam Guru Swabhimukham Swashakriya Agrishyade Tal Padadi Vabhadi Same Samantal Kvapadatviyam Khe Mahi Agrishtishakrishcha. The statement is not that the earth has attractive power too. No. The earth is attractive power also. There is difference in the statements. Newton proved that earth has attractive power also. Our rishi say the earth is attractive power too. See, he has universal love. He is
love personified. Both are different. That is the clarity of thought. Agrishti shakrishcha mahi taya yelkhastam guru. By that attractive force, it attracts objects which are above and which are material. Immaterial objects cannot be attracted. Shadow cannot be attracted. It is immaterial. Everything material will be attracted. Swashakriya swabhimukham agarshyade. With its own force, it attracts it towards the earth, to it. Tal patati ivabhadi. It is not falling. It looks like falling. He is very specific. And saying all this, one line is left for another explanation. Same samandal kuva patatviyam khe. When all the sides are equal, where is falling, where is jumping? So Aryabhatta had a very clear vision. Bhaskaracharya had a very clear vision. This is Bhaskaracharya's. That the earth was round. See, this is ignored. And the discovery of a theory of attraction is attributed to Sir Isaac Newton. There are 9 Sanskrit texts I have seen, there may be more, which were composed hundreds of years ago than these Western scientists, which are titled Gola Deepika, Gola Adhyayi, Gola Vijnana, etc., etc. Even then, we attribute the discovery to Copernicus. The earth is round. And it is taught in schools even after 56 years of independence. We ignore the treasure house of knowledges that were given to us by our rishis with specific informations like this. And we teach our children the Western attributes. You see, theory of evolution, Darwin's theory of evolution, 1,000 years ago, before Darwin, poet Kalidasa composed Kumar Sambhava. In the second adhyaya, there is a small Anushtup stanza. It is a praise by Devas to Brahma. Yad amogham apamandaruptam bijam aja tvaya adascharajaram vishwam prabhavastasya giyare. He aja, O Brahma, yel amogham bijam tvaya apam anta upram. See, you deposited a very powerful speck, an amoeba of life, in water. Adascharajaram vishwam prabhavastasya. Whatever you see in this universe, they are all emanated from that speck. Iti giyate. He says, not that I say that. Knowledgeable persons say that. The universe is the result of that evolution from that speck. This is in Kumar Sambhava, a very popular kavya. In Aryabhatta's text, the theory that sun is the center and earth is revolving around the sun, earth and other planets, specifically given, and a wonderful simile is also given. See, if you row a boat in a river where there's plenty of water and powerful flow, what will happen? You will feel that the trees on both sides are going back. That is the simile he has given. Like that, ever so many, it is endless. You can get, you pay 3 rupees, you can get a small booklet wherein 128 discoveries by our rishis are quoted. IIS, such Indian Institute of Scientific Heritage, has published a small booklet. You know Jyotisha, Jyotishastra is Vedanga, so ancient. One part of Jyotishastra is Golam, Prashnam, Jalagam, etc., etc. There are different chapters. One is Golam. In Vedas also there are ever so many stanzas mentioning about the evolution of the world, then the Saurayutha, solar system. They are all given. Evolution of the universe is much more beautifully given in Rig Veda than in the Big Bang theory. The state of affairs before the creation of the universe, very beautifully described.
Like that it goes. I need not recite all. Na asal asil. No sal asil. Tadanim. Tadanim, that is prior to the creation of the universe. Na asal asil. There was nothing unreal. No sal asil. Nor there was anything real. Tadanim, at that time. Na asil raja. Not even a speck of dirt. No bioma. No sky, no space. Paroyal. Then what not? Nothing. Na mrityur asil. There is no death. Amrtam na tarihi. Continued life is also not there. Na ratriya ahana asil. There is no night, no day. Like that, a poetical description of what was the state of affairs prior to the evolution, no, the creation of the universe. And the creation, the words they use, it is not Big Bang. The rishis say spodam. What does it mean? Sputikaranam. Making it visible, real. It was not visible prior to it. Then it became visible. That is sputikaranam, spodam. And then what is pravanjam? The universe. I don't know the exact meaning of the universe in the English language.
but in Sanskrit, prapancham is prakarishena panchikritam. Panchikritam means made panchabhutas. Prithivi, apas, tejas, vayu, agasham. Earth, water, fire, air and space. These are the panchabhutas. Previous to the revelation, there were no panchabhutas. So, prapancham is prakarishena panchikritam. Like that, all the knowledges contained in the ancient texts pronounced by the rishis were all crystal clear. They could understand everything as if they are visualizing it in before their eyes. These are all actually very relevant in this modern life also, because nowadays all the discoveries are only physical. Is it correct? There is limitation for physical observations. Real knowledge should come from within, not from without. In my humble opinion, the entire approach of research in our country should be totally changed. Vivekananda says, knowledge should come from within. Actually, where is the seat of knowledge? Only in the inner self. The yogins say, our body is consisting of pancha koshas across. Annamaya kosham, pranamaya kosham, manomaya kosham, and then only comes vijnanamaya kosham. The fourth. Last is anandamaya kosham. So knowledge, seat of knowledge is within you, not outside. The real knowledge should come from within. What is Gayatri Mantra? What is the prayer to Sun God? Tal Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiya Ya Ma Prachodayal. Tal Savitur Varenyam Bharga. The noble rays of the sun god, let it inspire your mind. Dhiya ya na prachodayan. Prachodana, what is prachodanam? Intuition. Let you have intuitions. That is automatic revelation of knowledge, that is intuition. Lord Buddha had an intuition. See, every great knowledge are the results of intuitions. There is a speck of intuition, there is an element of intuition. It must come from within. If our approach towards knowledge is drastically changed, if our mental discipline is stressed, we will have much more discoveries in our country than in Western worlds, because every knowledge given to us by rishis were only intuitions. How else it can be? They had no laboratories. They had no telescopes or microscopes. They had no instruments. But those rishis created airplanes that can travel more than by the speed of air, sound or light even. They created. There are ample proof in texts that there were vimanas in ancient India. And what not? How they could describe so exactly the state of affairs before creation? All intuitions. And it is no wonder. See, macrocosm and microcosm are the same. Brahmandam and Pindandam are the same. The Almighty, who is at the center of this universe, the most powerful entity, that Almighty is present in all, every one of you. You are a miniature universe. If you are not visualizing realities of the universe in your mind, it is only because of your mind is covered with dirt. It is not plain. Our rishis could make their mind, the mirror of mind, plain and wash all the dirt. Then what happened? Every knowledge available in this universe were reflected in them. They gave back to their disciples. The same process can be re-invoked, provided we change our attitude. Now we are borrowing technology from the West, borrowing instruments from the West. What research you are doing now, mostly in India, are all done at least 20 years ago in the West. We are all simply copying, imitating. All these knowledges are in you, in your mind, which is at present cannot be, it's easy, not easy to extract, because they are covered with dirt. There must be a method, a systematic method of training researchers in controlling their mind. Need not go for tapas. That is impossible. Within the realities of our modern day life, we can discipline our mind, we can train our minds to extract knowledge of the universe from our own hearts. There will be hundreds and hundreds of new discoveries in this country if the method adopted by the rishis are properly modified and adapted to the new realities of life in this country. See, it is foolish to go behind the Westerners in copying them and borrowing from them. We have to evolve our own methods. That is the application of the bygone values into the modern life. We can apply. That is what I believe. The approach should be different. Our eyes are blind now. We are blindly following the West. That method should be changed. We have to think back, go back to the ancient times and realize what they did. How they could exactly measure the speed of sound. How they could exactly measure the speed of light? They did. How could they measure the diameter of the earth and all other planets of the sun also without any instruments? It was not with the help of instruments. It was probing their own minds. All the realities of the universe were there in their minds. You had them in your minds also. How to take them out? How to realize it in your minds? That method should be evolved. There is nobody to teach you now, but still there are yogins and tapaswins in the Himalayan ranges who are well versed in controlling their minds. We can get upadesham from them. You have to remodel it. Don't go, all of you go to the caves in Himalayas and do tapas. No. With the realities of the modern life in mind, we can adopt the methods evolved by our ancient rishis in realizing the truths of nature, truth of the universe. That we have to adopt. I don't think it is easy, because 56 years have elapsed since the independence, and so far we haven't realized that we have a rich past. The lessons given by our rishis are not given to the growing generations. Here and there some people realize, they praise, but the society at large don't accept them because the administrators refuse to open their eyes. This attitude should change, and it will change. I'm sure it will change, because why the CMD invited me to talk here? I'm not a scientist. I'm not a technocrat. I'm not even a graduate. Why he invited? There is a realization that there are treasure houses of knowledges in the ancient wisdom. And we have to study at least part of them. There is a realization in the top echelons of scientific community also. That is the reason why people like me are accepted. So, a good start is in the offing. We have to imbibe the values of the bygone days of this country. No other country is rich enough as our Bharata in knowledges, in all walks of life, whether it is in the scientific front, whether it is yoga, whatever you mention, in all walks of life, we have abundance of knowledges that we have to redigest, reinvent even. It is possible. See, mind is a treasure house of everything. You just look around. Mada Amrdanandamayi visited Hyderabad. Thousands thronged her. Scientists, great scientists are coming. Is there any acceptance like that? Sai Baba is worshipped by lakhs of people. What is the reason? There is something we which gives you peace of mind in these people, in Amrutanandamayi, Sai Baba, etc. That is not available from sciences. That is not available from technology. That is not available from the riches the modern science produce. So the most valuable thing is the mind, not other instruments or knowledge available from without. You have to look into your mind. A new trend is to be developed. The values we have, a treasure house of them, plenty of them, they are simply ignored nowadays. And all the Western values are accepted in life. This has done a lot of harm. In our dress, in our foods, in our houses,